Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and iOS 15.5 RC has been out for the past few days. I've been using it full-time on my iPhone 13 Pro Max and also my iPad Pro. I wanted to share the overall experience like I do every week on these weekly Apple iOS updates, and also wanted to share your opinion based off the YouTube community poll, where at the time of this video there's almost 7,000 votes and almost 100 comments. I've read all of the comments to get the best understanding of what iOS 15.5 is like, and 15.5 RC or release candidate means that this will be the final version released to the public if there's not additional issues. So we'll talk about bugs, battery life, performance, and I did want to mention a new feature or change that seems a bit odd. Now, iOS 15.5 is basically a few features such as Apple Pay Cash, Apple Podcast settings and bug fixes, and a few developer updates as well, such as the PS5 controller trigger update, so they can implement those into games. However, this update has an odd settings under settings, and if you tap into your iCloud account, so if you tap your name, go into iCloud, you'll see here if we scroll down, there's setup and sleep lock screen. Now this is something that doesn't seem to belong there, but could be new features or something they forgot to take out of the release candidate. So this is something I'm seeing on the release candidate ones with no icon there, and it doesn't make sense, but it's something that I'm seeing. I'm also seeing duplicates here. So you'll see where we have messages. If we scroll up, we have messages at the top. Those shouldn't be there, and that should be fixed. So there's definitely still some bugs, meaning this could lead to an iOS 15.5 RC2 earlier this coming week if they don't release it. We'll talk more about that in a little bit. So we have those duplicates here. I'm not sure if the settings or the setup is a feature or something else, but hopefully they resolve this maybe with a final version with a different build number. We'll have to wait and see. Now this past week we also got AirPods updates to version 4E71. I did a separate video about that, and you can update that pretty simply. I talked about that in a separate video, but the update's now available, and once you install it, you'll have better connectivity in general. So most people have better connectivity, some people have better noise canceling and audio quality overall, and it's definitely worth updating if you haven't already. Also, we had AirTags updates, and those have been rolling out over the past few weeks. However, if you have your AirTag nearby, it should have already updated to version 1.0.301. So that's now showing in Find My for me. It took a while, but it finally updated. And you can see here from my backpack AirTag that I have right here, it's on version firmware 1.0.301. So it finally updated. Unfortunately, there's no quick way to get them to update. Now, as far as the overall experience, the experience has been pretty good, with the exception of the first day. I had touch locking up on me, and it seemed to be an issue. So I would just maybe go into an app, and then it would completely freeze. Or I'd go into settings, and I couldn't scroll. I'd have to close out of those apps, go back in, and then it would finally work again. So that's something I had that was a bit odd. It doesn't seem to have happened since, but it was the first day. I also had issues with Apple Music and cellular data the first day, but it looks like that got resolved from an Apple Music outage that was going on. So there seemed to be a problem with iCloud again. Apple has since resolved that, and it seems to be working again. But you'll see I have 5G with 5G UC. It seems to be working fine. So that was an issue earlier on. It seems to have been resolved over the past few days. However, I did have someone say that MagSafe wallets were not being recognized for some reason, so that seems to have been resolved now, but it seems to be working pretty well according to most of you, but I did have those odd issues. However, as far as additional bugs, I have had people mention issues with CarPlay, so that's still an issue. And there's still that issue if you have Spotify down in the bottom or a third-party app that's music down in the dock, you reinstall the music app, it will take the place of it right here. That's still a bug in this update. So I can demonstrate that here, but it deletes all of my Apple Music. But if I have that maybe on my iPhone 11, so on my iPhone 11, you can see I have Spotify in the bottom right. Maybe we go to reinstall the music app. We'll tap on reinstall here, give it just a moment. As I'm on the wireless connection from my iPhone, using it as a hotspot, you'll see it's already taken the place of it in the bottom right in the dock. It's taking the place of Spotify, and it's changed a little bit. So that's something they've done in this update that needs to be fixed, and it's definitely a problem. Now, Apple has actually acknowledged it, but they haven't fixed it with 15.5. And so as far as that goes, there's not a whole lot of bugs that people are mentioning, but there's a few small things here and there. Most people say performance and battery life is great, and everything is working well for most people. That's a good sign, but there are still those bugs that I mentioned, and you can duplicate those on your own device. Performance on older devices is also quite good. So if you're concerned, maybe you have an iPhone 6S, 6S Plus, iPhone 7, or an 8 Plus like this one, it's working fine. There's no issues with scrolling, going into apps, or going into anything else. It's just nice and fast all the time. I'm offline here, so you won't see that in music, but if we open the camera, you'll see it's nice and fast to open, snaps a photo quickly, and there's not really any issues with it, so performance is great. As far as battery life, if we go into settings, go down to battery, my battery health is at 100%. I put this on the charger every night, it's never really an issue for me, and it's seemingly lasting much better than the previous versions. And also there's a plane flying overhead very close, so it's part of filming outside, I suppose. If we take a look at the battery life from the past couple of days, yesterday I had 2 hours and 39 minutes of screen on time, 4 hours and 48 minutes of screen off time. The day before that, I had 3 hours and 55 minutes of screen on time, 4 hours and 7 minutes of screen off time. And you can see recently deleted apps is missing the icon here now too. So there's definitely some odd bugs here and there, but it's getting me to about 50% usage by the end of the day. Not great, but it's better for most people. I think I need to reinstall the OS overall on this phone. Just so many betas stacked on top of one another seem to pose a problem. Now, as far as someone else's battery life, they sent it to me on Instagram. This is for an 11 Pro Max from Abhishek. You can see he had 4 hours and 15 minutes of screen on time, 1 hour and 31 minutes of screen off time, used about 55% of his battery. So it's doing pretty well for most people. Most are not complaining about it in the comments, so we'll look at that in just a moment. Now, as far as my iPad battery life, that's a different story still. As far as my iPad goes, I charged it a little bit before this video, and you can see here that over the last 10 days, yesterday I only had 2 hours and 18 minutes of screen on time with 1 hour and 10 minutes of screen off time. Again, it's getting me 5 or 6 hours of screen on time. So it's not great, but I haven't had any issues with iPadOS at all. Now, I did run benchmarks on these devices, and they're scoring pretty well. 1,730 for single core, 4,748 for multi-core. That's on my iPhone 13 Pro Max. Based on the history, that's right where it should be. So it's working fine. Again, like I said, no performance issues. And you see that on older devices as well. So on the iPhone 8 Plus that's on the right, we have 907 for single core, 2,311 for multi-core. On the iPhone 11, 1,323 for single core, 3,345 for multi-core. So overall performance is pretty good. As far as when to expect iOS 15.5 releasing to the public, we can expect that as soon as this coming Monday or Tuesday. Now, Apple does need to address those bugs I've already mentioned, so we could see a couple different scenarios. We could see an RC2 or Release Candidate 2, or they could skip that and just do a different build number with iOS 15.5's public release. We won't know that until they release them, but we've seen those scenarios happen in the past. Then maybe if they need to address future security updates and bug fixes, we'll have an iOS 15.5.1. But also I would expect this coming week or early next week is iOS 15.6 betas. So that's what we see with Apple all the time. We'll keep seeing iOS 15 betas all the way until September when we have the release of iOS 16. So if they keep with what they've done for many, many years, that's what we'll see. Of course, many people will care much more about iOS 16 beta 1 that we'll see on June 6th. So we'll have iOS 16 beta 1 with iOS 15 betas all the way up until September. Now, as far as additional things I wanted to mention, Apple looks to be switching away from Lightning at some point to USB-C. This is to adhere to some rules that they have to for the European Union, and it makes sense with data transfers when you're using Apple Pro Raw. So if you're using Pro Raw or ProRes video, you need to get those huge files off your phone, and it's much easier to do with a faster USB-C cable than it is with Lightning or AirDrop. So that makes sense. Maybe we'll see it as soon as iPhone 13, but it's looking to be more of an iPhone 14 release, so we'll probably see it then. Now let's take a look at the YouTube community poll and some of your comments, and at the time of this video, like I said, there's almost 7,000 votes. And you'll see 17% of you are using the release candidate, or the final version right now. 72% of you are waiting and are on 15.4.1 or older, 1% are on 14.8.1 or older, 1% are also on 13.7 or older, and 8% are using Android. Now let's go ahead and take a look at some of the comments. I have my iPad below here. Evan Coleman said, I'm running iOS 15.5 RC on my iPhone 13 mini. There seems to be a bit of battery drain after installing the update. And quite a few of you have said that I don't really read enough negative comments. And this time around, there just wasn't that many negative comments to read. So that's a great thing. I think it's doing fine based off what you've had to say anyway. Francesca Perry said, running iOS 15.5 RC on my iPhone 13 Pro Max, iPhone 7 Plus, and iPhone 6S. And as expected, all three devices are running perfectly smooth and stable. No lag or stutters in animations or UI. AirPods Max connect instantly to my iPhones. System data storage is down to under 4 GB. And most people are saying the same thing. It still can be above 10 gigabytes depending on what it's doing, but for the most part, system storage seems better. Also, and apps open and close just fine, and battery life has been great on all three devices, even on the iPhone 6S. I also have the iOS 15.5 RC installed on my iPad 8th gen and iPad 5th gen. And thankfully, it has made the battery life on my iPads better than 15.4.1. When playing games on my iPad 8th gen, the battery would go down to under 90% in under 40 minutes, but now I get a full hour of use without going below 90%. Love the videos, Aaron. Hope you see this comment. Hope you have a great week and a great weekend. Thanks, and I hope you do too. And thanks to everyone that's commented. And of course, with all of those devices having good battery life, that's a pretty good sign based off what Francesca said here. David B. said, I think there's going to be an RC2. CarPlay for me anyway is a bit clunky and cut out completely and couldn't reconnect. And I see this over and over, probably since iOS 14 at this point. It just seems to be an issue with CarPlay. Giannis Zervis said, I'm on iOS 15.5 RC since its release on my iPhone 12. As you already mentioned in your video, it's not a major update, but mostly a bug fix update. Based on my Geekbench scores, performance is a little lower, but that doesn't tell the whole story in real life use. As far as battery life goes, I have to say I'm impressed. I've managed to get 8 hours of screen on time on the first full charge after installing iOS 15.5 RC, which is great for a device that's 2 years old with 87% battery health. That's all. Enjoy your content every time. And thank you. And I think, like you said, it's doing well for most people. So I think you're going to see the same trend here. Jamie said, this is the first 15.5 beta release that I've installed on my iPhone 11. And in less than 48 hours, the battery life has improved compared with 15.4.1. And 7 other people actually gave it a thumbs up also. So I think this is a good sign. It's doing much better for most people. Of course, there's always going to be bugs as no software is perfect. And if you're wondering if you should install it, well, definitely when it releases to the public, or if you're on a previous beta, I would recommend installing it. At this point, it's as good as iOS 15 has ever gotten, and I definitely recommend it. Now, if you found anything else I didn't mention, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. And of course, if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.